Is without prejudice that the armed forces of Nigeria is operating in one of the most difficult conflict environments today. We are the stress of nation building, international attention, and political experiences all combined to create a cocktail of challenges that commanders at all levels have to deal with. Today's success in operations is more about detection than mass. And success in war more focused on complex integration of civilian and military, state and non-state entities, culture and governments, and economics and ideology. The complexity of warfare has therefore pushed the discipline of command and control to the front of the stage with acute burden of responsibility on commanders. The larger and more sophisticated the force becomes, the greater the difficulties in preserving its cohesion and fighting power. Command is vested in the commander by a higher authority that gives him direction, often encapsulated in a mission, and assigns forces to him to accomplish that mission. It therefore encompasses the authority, responsibility, and duty to act, to deploy, for example, his assigned forces to fulfill their given mission. Military command at all levels, whether ground strategic, military strategic, and operational tactical, is the act of decision making, motivating, and directing all ranks into action to accomplish missions. Closely associated with command is the concept of control. Control is a process through which the commander, assisted by his staff, organizes, directs, and coordinates the activities of the forces allocated to him. Command and control are first inextricably linked with commanders and staff, requiring knowledge and understanding of both and the roles of each other if they are to perform their duties effectively. Command and control, however, are not equal partners, as control is merely one aspect of command. Therefore, this paper will refer to command as implicitly encompassed by both command and control. The term command, leadership, and management, the terms command, leadership, and management are closely related. Command at its highest level involves ultimately responsibility for the force or organization and, to be effective, requires a wide range of qualities and skills. The purpose of this paper, therefore, is to discuss the attributes of command and its body of responsibility, drawing examples from contemporary military operations in Nigeria. Therefore, the aim of this paper is to discuss the body of command responsibility in contemporary military operations in Nigeria. To cover this, I'm discussing quickly the conceptual clarification, attributes of command, body of command responsibility, case study from combat insurgency operations in Iraq, contemporary military operations in Nigeria, and my thoughts on some of the things we could do. Conceptual clarifications. Command is a position of authority and responsibility to which military men and women are constitutionally and legally appointed. Leadership and management are the key components in the successful exercise of command. However, commanders are not leaders. Let me emphasize that. Commanders are not leaders until their position has been ratified in the hearts and minds of those they command. Leadership is not a position or a title. It is action and example. Command itself is vested in an individual who is responsible for the direction, coordination, and control of military forces and control of military forces. Consequently, the commander is legally and professionally accountable and responsible for everything those assigned forces do or fail to do, as well as being subordinate to civil power within the framework of the Constitution. Let's take a look at leadership. Leadership is a projection of personality and character to inspire those under command to do what is required of them. Skill or the skill or the techniques of leadership is a foremost quality in the art of command and contributes very largely to operational success. There is no prescription for leadership and any prescribed type of leader. Great leadership, which means to be visionary, is a combination of example, persuasion, and compulsion, dependent on the situation. The true task of a leader is to inspire people to achieve more than they thought they could, not because you inspire them to, but because you create the space in which they will fully achieve success spectacularly. The leader brings people to the place where they achieve greatness and afterwards say, we did it ourselves. The success of the leader comes not through the salutes or the deference or the best seats or functions, but from seeing the people in his charge become more than they ever thought they could be. The true leader, after having created that place for success, fades into the background so that the followers can claim their victory. In the words of the former American president, Ronald Reagan, he said, "The greatest leader is not necessarily the one who does the greatest things. He's the one that gets people to do the greatest things." Successful military leaders, according to Sun Tzu, are those who understand themselves, the organization, the opponents, and the environment in which they operate, and the people that they are privileged to lead. Leadership, according to the British Army Guide, is the lifeblood of any army. Our military leaders must be responsible and influential. Let's take a look at management, which is, like I said earlier, part of the functions of command. Management is the act of running and controlling a business or similar organization and is a facet of command. It is about the allocation and control of resources, either human, material, or financial, to achieve objectives. Management of men and resources requires the ability to deploy techniques and skills to enhance and facilitate the planning, organization, and execution of the business of defense, even in the face of limited resources and possibly of funds. A successful commander combines these management skills with those of leadership to achieve the desired outcome. Therefore, command, leadership, and management with responsibilities are intertwined and are complementary ingredients to one successful command of men and resources to achieve assigned missions and objectives. Let's take a look at the attributes of command. According to General John Michael Law of the United States Air Force, command is a sacred trust. Therefore, commanders are awarded a special trust and confidence to fulfill their unit's mission and care for their people with leadership, discipline, justice, fairness, unflagging integrity, moral courage, accountability, and compassion in peace and war. These qualities would also include loyalty, either horizontal or vertical, professionalism, flexibility, creativity, and resourcefulness, as well as respect for others and selfless commitment, highlights the universal attributes required of commanders across worlds and forces, with the armed forces of Nigeria being no exception. There are three separate but related dimensions of command, which are legal and process, individual command, and organizational command. Command in the Armed Forces of Nigeria has a legal and constitutional status as enshrined in the 1999 Constitution of Nigeria's amended and further amplified it in the Armed Forces Act. Basically, there are two styles of individual command: an inflexible authoritarian form of top-down command in which subordinates receive rigid orders that leave little or no space to exercise low-level initiative. By contrast, a mission command emphasizes mission type orders, the superior commander sets broad objectives and allows subordinates to use their initiative to achieve their part of the plan in the way that they think best. In the context of our army, Our emphasis is always on mission command. Organizational command is related to organizational design as human beings profit from living in structured groups. And irrespective of the organizational design, for example, a hierarchical network or cellular or even a combination of both, organizations require a structure so that work can be divided to achieve coordination among its various components. Organizational command therefore centers on the issues of division of labor, allocation of authority, and departmentalization as span of control. Two British social scientists, Barnes and Stalker, labeled organizations as either mechanistic or organic. The armed forces, for example, employed a mechanistic organizational structure with tight rules and policies, limited individual job discretion and coordination, which is good for morale and unity. At the organizational level in the military, senior commanders make countless decisions about the division of labor, delegation of authority, departmentalization and span of control to make their command functional. And let's look at the burden of command responsibility. The origin of command responsibility or superior responsibility dates back over 2 centuries ago. Sun Tzu wrote in his Treatise, The Art of War, about the duty of commanders to ensure that subordinates conduct themselves with a certain level of civility in armed conflicts. The command responsibility doctrine, which is a tool of the international criminal law since the Conference of Versailles in 1919, creates such an incentive that holding civilian superiors and military commanders criminally liable for failing to prevent crimes and for failing to prosecute guilty subordinates. The burden of command responsibility is a concept that showcases the challenges a commander faces in the exercise of command in a unit or formation. Taking responsibility of the failure of the unit is the media of officers and soldiers, administration of troops and family, decision making, control of troops, financial and logistics challenges. This responsibility is based on the failure to prevent or punish subordinates for their unlawful actions. Under the international humanitarian law, the Hague Conventions of 1949 and the Geneva Conventions of 1929, commanders have a duty to ensure that their troops respect that body of law during armed conflicts and hostilities. Failure to do so, they give rise to liability. A mere breach of duty whereby the commander has not fulfilled the responsibilities expected of his rank is usually dealt with through disciplinary action. However, when a commander fails to prevent or punish violations of international humanitarian law by subordinates, criminal proceedings are likely, and the punishment to be meted out will defend the gravity and nature of the crime committed by the subordinate. Many criticisms have triggered the application of the statutes as some have seen as a Western tool to further imperialism and victor's justice, as both sides in any conflict are not immune to committing atrocities to some extent. Examples were cited of human rights abuses at Abu Ghraib prison in 2004 and cases of extrajudicial killings abound. There have been criticisms of U.S. deployment of armed drones in Iraq and Afghanistan, which have led to the killings of innocent civilians in what Americans often dismiss as collateral damage. However, the supporters of President allies have pointed out that the United States and some of our allies are not signatories to the Rome Statutes of International Criminal Courts. Hence, their service personnel cannot be tried by the courts, but rather the national courts, which have been accused of imposing life sentences for obvious human rights abuses and war crimes. The recently released 7 years chamber report in the United Kingdom on Iraq invasion by the US and Britain blamed the then British Prime Minister Tony Blair for misleading the nation through false intelligence reports on Saddam Hussein's possession of weapons of mass destruction to war in which several thousands of innocent lives, especially Iraqis, were killed. The invasion, which has led to the massive destruction of Iraq, factionalize the country and the eventual rise of the Islamic State of Levant as an ISIL. Trapping world peace has led to a call for a trial of both George Bush and Tony Blair by International Criminal Court. Ultimately, it has been established that responsibility for troops' behavior lies with their commanders. Various colleges have enshrined rules of behavior that, in as much detail as possible, deal with and are aimed at ensuring the compliance with external laws. These include codes of conduct and rules of engagement. This will be discussed this week, but before taking a look at our counter-insurgency operations in Iraq and in Nigeria, let us look at the code of conduct. The moral component of fighting power is concerned with the least predictable aspect of conflict, which is the human element. This makes it arguably the most difficult to define and to deal with it in the practical sense. Nevertheless, the human element is the one that wins and loses battles. If time and effort is invested in it, all things become possible, and if it is neglected, no amount of resources will compensate for it. It is built upon three commodities, which are ethical foundations, moral cohesion, and motivation. The ethical foundations of the moral component are interwoven construction that derives their strength from their relationships with each other. They are solidarity and humanity. Therefore, the moral component requires care and effort to be invested in understanding and protecting a number of standards which are developed through general morality and ethics. The rule of law, legitimacy, and the laws of armed conflict, as well as rules of engagement. The Nigerian Army first issued a detailed code of conduct during the Civil War of 1967 to 1970. It also issued one during the economic operations in Liberia and Sierra Leone. These were later revised when those operations were taken over by the United Nations, with new rules and subsequently concisely captured in various publications, produced under guidance and headquarters at various times. In consonance with military discipline and hierarchy, therefore, the first point commanders at various levels to ensure not only that those of them are familiar with these guiding principles, but they obey their provisions. Similarly, the Nigerian Army ethics, customs, and traditions specify standards of conduct that govern the service lives of all personnel. These standards are necessary due to the close-knit nature of the military community, which make the consequences of loss of trust severe. They include the service test, which is the acceptable standard of evaluation of service personnel behavior in the performance of military duty. Others are adherence to the law, adherence to ethos and values and cooperation with sister services. There's also the adherence to oaths, will to win, and dedication to duty. To support these are recognized taboos like bullying, discrimination, substance abuse, and religious intolerance, amongst others. Let's take a look at the rules of engagement. Rules of engagement have been defined as goals, directives issued by competent military authority that delineate the circumstances and limitations under which armed forces will initiate and or continue combat engagement with other forces encounter. Rules of engagement therefore performs three main functions. The first to provide guidance from the government to the body units on the use of force for mission accomplishment, and the exercise of the inherent right and obligation of unit self-defense. Secondly, to act as a control mechanism for the transition from peacetime to combat operations, and finally, it provides a mechanism to facilitate planning and training. When properly drafted and implemented, rules of engagement enables mission accomplishment, force protection, and compliance with law and policy. Rules of engagement is the commander's rules for the use of force. Therefore, he's expected to be familiar with them and ensure personnel under command are also familiar with them. Rules of engagement ensures that national policy and objectives are reflected in the action of commanders in the field. particularly under circumstances in which communication with higher authority is not possible. Consequently, if any aspect of rule of engagement is not clear or inadequate for the particular operation at hand, it falls to the commander to clarify it or seek a modification as soon as possible. The Nigerian Army has made concerted efforts to produce a robust rules of engagement for various operations it has conducted and we are still engaged in. This invariably enhances conduct of operations without just exercise restraint in reaction to attacks, despite the explicit provisions for self-defense in all rules of engagement that the Nigerian Army operates. Commanders will continue to ensure compliance through improved training, supervision, and provision of timely clarifications where they are required. Before I go to the next heading, which is manifestly in the order, let me take a quick and just talk before the rules of the day. One of the challenges that we face presently is interpretation of our rules of the game, especially by the political and legal entities in our state. For instance, the issue of self-defense. One of the things I found out in the course of my job as a GSO over the last 1 year is that there is a misconception, I would say, that self-defense only means once you are fired at, then you use a weapon. And I've challenged some of our civilian friends and some political leaders that that's absolutely wrong. Each and every one of you is quite familiar with some of the things that we have seen happening in the United States. For instance, a police stops you and wants to check. The mere fact that you drop your hands into your pocket is seen as a threat. And you don't wait to find out what that threat is. Because he has given a clear order, look, hands on the steering, come out of the car. Any other thing you want to do other than that is seen as a threat. And that threat is dealt with. Secondly, is the definition of arms. The least weapon available for operations is a rifle. When troops are fiercely attacked by extremist groups or militants, let's, for the sake of our discussion, say it's just about using people, bows and arrows, machete, all kinds of heavy weapons. These in itself, these weapons are also dangerously crude weapons that could kill. Our soldiers do not possess a machete or a catapult or bow and arrows. And we are facing this challenge today because the Nigerian Army is increasingly undertaking police functions. We find a wave of extremists brandishing locally with pistols, machete, bows and arrows, attacking troops in waves. Like we say, then we say a way to let me go and get machete too. But that's what they are holding. Because those people are killed. They're injured. They're maimed. And under the rules of engagement, those troops are right to defend themselves with the weapon available to them, and that is the rifle. When militants or extremist groups or whatever throw bullets or cocktails at troops, we don't expect those troops under our charge to sit by Because they are coming out, because those are IEDs. These are some of the things that we need to get clear, especially to those who want to exploit these loopholes to take shots at the man. And we must interpret those actions in relation to what is the expected outcome of that engagement. If we have to, in the course of operation, 10, 20, 30, or whatever people die, to save a larger number of people, you are perfectly right within the rules of engagement. Because it's explicit states that you have the authority to protect either the property or the persons of people under your charge. Look at what's happening in the Southeast. The South South, in the Southwest, the Northeast, all over the whole country. And their army troops are constantly engaged in operations in which very dangerous weapons are unleashed at them. They cannot stand back. What are the guys that those people are not holding pistols or arms? Even if somebody comes with you with a blade and threatens your life, and you have a weapon, take him out. Because that blade, as small as it is, selling for probably $1 or $2, can kill. I'll continue. Let's go to manifestly illegal orders. In many contexts in which war crimes are committed by military personnel, subordinates will plead that there will be many foreign orders when carrying out certain unlawful actions. More often than not, the subordinate will not question the legality of an order. There being an inbuilt presumption that superiors are better placed to determine wrong from right in the conduct of hostilities. At other times, though, where the order seems to go beyond what is legally permissible, the subordinate will be faced with the choice: disobey and face possible reprimand and punishment by the superior or a court martial, or obey and risk criminal punishment by acting upon an order which has unlawful consequences. Over the rank of the subordinate, the more difficult it may be to disobey an illegal order. And that's very true. You can see what has happened in Turkey over the last few days. I think it was this morning when I was catching the CNN news. So 99 generals and admirals have been charged, and over 6,000. Now, as far as we can, I can easily make a deduction. Most likely, about 60% of those people are arrested. We don't even know that a coup was in the offing. They may not know. And that's what this statement tries to clarify. So that's why it becomes important that in our training, we also educate our troops and our subordinates on how to determine, as much as practicable, what are illegal orders. Like I said, the lower the rank of the subordinate, the more difficult it may be to disobey an illegal order. This raises a dilemma, both moral and legal, for the subordinates. To disobey an order can lead to reprimand and demotion of even court martial. Hence, allowing the subordinates to raise the defense of superior orders recognizes that subordinates within the military have little or no discretion in questioning orders from their superiors. Let's take a quick look at a case study from counter-insurgent operations in Iraq. The invasion subsequent and associated occupation and counter operations in Iraq and Afghanistan highlighted both the difficulty in maintaining appropriate behaviors among troops and the consequences of such failure. The major combat troops contributors to these operations via the United States and the United Kingdom. Both first world countries with highly trained, well-funded, and properly equipped militaries. The countries have different approaches to the provisions of the Geneva Convention, with the United States of America being a non-participant, in the establishment of the International Criminal Court. However, both employ their national law enforcement mechanism to try their service personnel that committed human rights abuses and war crimes. Despite this, they both experience situations where their troops behave in an unprofessional manner with serious implications on mission success and operational security. Between 2002 and 2006, over 100 detainees died in the hands of United States troops conducting war on terror, with the U.S. authorities admitting that at least 34 of these were homicides. One of the most prominent among these was an Iraqi general, Abed Hamid Mahosh, who was beaten, tortured, and subsequently died of asphyxiation after a U.S. warrant officer stuck him in a sleeping bag, sat on his chest, and covered his mouth and nose. This was despite the fact that the Iraqi general had no useful information on what the U.S. forces wanted to know, like the locations of the weapons of mass destruction that the suspected Saddam Hussein government was hiding. This case points to the reality that even one of the world's largest and best-funded military still has gaps in training and supervision that could lead to grave violations by troops if left unsupervised. It also highlights the need for the Nigerian Army not to rest on its powers and for commanders to ensure that they are always on top of the situation when it comes to the training and supervision of their troops. As Brigadier General David Ivan, retired from the United States Army, said, "The torture and death catalogued in excruciating detail did not happen spontaneously. They are the consequences of a shocking breakdown of command discipline on the part of the Army Officers Corps." Unquote. What is unquestionably broken is the fundamental principle of command, accountability, and that starts at the very top. It is therefore important that commanders brief and supervise the actions of their subordinates properly and ensure code of conduct and rules of engagement are strictly adhered to. Immediate sanctions of abuses and war crimes with stiff penalties would not serve as deterrent apart from assuaging victims of crimes and their families. The doctrine of command responsibility plays a fundamental role in regulating behavior of superiors and their subordinates in times of war or other military operations. Let's look at contemporary military operations in Nigeria vis-à-vis command responsibility. Nigeria's strife for nationhood is besieged with a lot of inherent problems leading to most of its internal conflicts, as we see today. Since the restoration of democracy in 1999, Nigeria has witnessed a sharp rise in violent internal conflicts threatening our national security. This situation has led the federal government to activate Section 217 of the 1999 Constitution, which challenges the Nigerian Army to defend Nigeria from external aggression, maintain its territorial integrity, and secure its borders from violation, and also suppressing insurrection and acting in aid of civil authority to restore order when called upon to do so. This last constitutional provision is what is guiding our conduct of operations across the country today. And that is the subject that we need to really have serious engagement with our political leaders to define actually what it means when we're involved in internal security operations. Like you all know, and like all of you are involved, the Nigerian Army today is in virtually every state of the Federation of the Western. As I speak now, as you sit down there, operations are going on. Our troops are in virtually everywhere. Up to 2 a.m. this morning, I'll sit talking to some of my troops in the field, conduct some operations. Now, the fluidity of these operations demands that our supreme commander must have some form of flexibility, or else there will be a danger to our national security. The social political situations leading to high rates of youth unemployment, environmental degradation, especially in the Niger Delta, internationally contagious religious extremism, ethnic rivalry and political brinkmanship, and endemic corruption, as well as proliferation of small arms, have been a catalyst for the mirror of violence in Nigeria, necessitating the involvement of the military to quell and restore order. That comes to clearly. From Odi to Zaki Dam, Akaifuab to Zaria, and now, and of course, the Boko Haram insurgency calling it on, military operations have been subject of public scrutiny, especially in local and international, as well as social media. However, most of the allegations made against the armed forces on human rights abuse have been found to be orchestrated by perpetrators of these violent acts and their sympathizers to discredit the armed forces and most especially the government. Let me take a question, because we are all sitting here, same armed forces. Let me just give you a glimpse of what happened in Zaria. On the 12th of December, President Commander in Chief was in Kaduna for the convocation of Kaduna City University, and thereafter to open a musical concert organized by the All Progressive Congress Party to appreciate all those who supported them during the elections. Just before then, he just finished the class annual conference. So I told him before, because Mr. President was coming to my area, particularly to Kaduna, and of course, arrived at Kaduna. Welcome, Mr. President, together with the executive governor and other political dignitaries. Went to the castle, finished competition, went to the stadium, Amadbello Stadium, everything went well. Saw Mr. President on the polo field, and I looked at my time. I said I had enough time to catch up with the chief of army, who was to come in about that afternoon. It would be of temple legend. If I spoke that day, I was even sick. I started the promise of Maria City of Biosecure. I just had to push that because my chief was around. When we come in, I just wanted to quickly dash to Zaria. So myself, I think my DIC and my commander put this in. I was even nauseous. I had to call for Swiss just to suppress my nausea. And then we are on the way to Zaria. I think just before the institute, I got a call from my officer that there was a problem in Zaria. That's what we said there. Some bands of IBM were shared, so the block we did at the two was able to pass. What he told me, I couldn't comprehend. I said, no, I couldn't remember. I said, how? I know, what do you mean? He said, sir, they blocked me from passing. I said, I was trying to ask me, black as a blocking. He said, yes, sir. What happened? He said, I don't know. Okay, I said, okay, keep it talking to me. I asked my grandma, fire this girl, let's have a service to the I'm going to there. I think I just asked Janji, but I call the colleague, sir, it's getting bad. And of course, you know, in Kaduna, we have Operation Yaki, which is, of course, the Operation Mesa, but East States gives its own name. So in Kaduna, it's Operation Yaki, and we have the deployed all over Kaduna. And of course, Depot keeps also there because they also have their own secret arena for purpose of the POP. And I said, look, just do what is necessary so that the chief can go ahead to where he was going. I was already on my way. Of course, when I eventually got to Zaria, of course, the chief's convoy had broken through. Actually, I don't know what happened when that would happen. And I got to Depot and I called my commander and said, let me give a quick assessment. You know, because to me it was inconceivable that some people, seeing a well-armed convoy, would deliberately halt and having been told that, look, this is the chief officer convoy. People claim. Tell me, they said, the chief was able to break through forcefully. And that was right. It's right to me to write tomorrow and to me to write always. Because, like I said, the chief of army staff is a symbol of the president's manufacturer of his power as commander-in-chief. Now, it should have ended there. And of course, because of what happened, I was trying to find out, look, I hope this is not going to get to something else. Now, what we had was that the IMF, they are massive, brandishing all kinds of weapons would have been on display when the chief had to force his way through. I looked around some parts of Zaria, and what I saw was shocking. We saw hundreds of young men brandishing all kinds of people in a densely populated place like Zaria. I don't need a soothsayer to know that. If you do not intervene, Zaria was going to burn. The police had no capability to do anything. They were attacking me. I discussed this with the chief of army staff. It's okay, what you need to do to arrest the situation, we must conduct a speed, conduct a quick thorough search. I come by somebody commanders. If I have to send on my camouflage so I could change, you know, into my combat dress. We got intel, some locals are giving us information about movement of these people to three key areas. The big Ozenia, the small shrine, and the residence of. But because I wanted to be double sure of what I was hearing, I said, okay, let me just take a quick tour. As I was going, they were attacking troops. Don't forget, we had deployed troops in Zaire as part of Operation Yaki. And I said, okay, we need to conduct a coronal search. One, to take away all those deadly weapons, because if not, mayhem will unleash in Zaria. A city of, I'm talking about, 500,000 people. When we started moving into those areas, we came under all kinds of attack, including ramming our APC with their cars. Because they wanted to deny us movements to go and conduct a coronal search. My officer called them, Babayo. I told them, calm down, put that gently, simple instructions. And I'm very proud of this officer, so that's an illegal to try. I stand by Jimmy, I stand by tomorrow. Because if he didn't do that, the lives of hundreds of people would have been serious to be by many more deaths in Zaria. They had checkpoints, sandbag checkpoints, had all kinds of things. We passed over, they were moving. We insisted we must follow the search, and they said they're not going to do it. And we are the states. We are not bands of hooligans. And of course, I'm sure you all know the whole story. And because of that, a lot of people died. They died. You know that, like, it's been running around. Unfortunately, that they were killed, they used the word kill, but there was a joke of an engagement. They dropped bombs, bows and spears, locally made big soldiers, right? I lost a soldier. General Babai was almost killed, he was stabbed by a lady, and we took the necessary action. And under that circumstance, I would take the same action, because the larger impact of security must not be compromised. I'll go. For instance, the military groups in Niger Delta, moving for the emancipation of Niger Delta and Niger Delta Volunteer Force, often dressed some of their members in Nigerian military uniforms in unwholesome activities and having pictures posted on social media, or sent to undesigning media houses to win sympathy and to also discredit the armed forces. These acts have been instrumental in compelling some designing not designing international human rights groups like Amnesty International to latch on their reports on Nigeria. According to Major General who already retired, false accusations against the military has not often been based on wrong premises and falsehood for online social media like Sarah reporters, sensationalism, and AIS continues to rehash of its blackmail and calculated attempt to rubbish the reputation as well as the image of the military. The same position was held by the former military head of state, General Yakubu Gowon, who demanded unreserved apology from Amnesty International for his report on the arms and U.S. operations in the Northeast. These accusations tacitly ignore the devastation that non-military interventions or operations may likely impact on the civil populace. Again, let me quickly take a pause here. One of the things we need to educate our people is the meaning, in practical terms, of national security, of national interests. And yet to see that, especially in some sectors of our polity. Like I said about the issue of the IMA, this is a group that has explicitly professed that it does not respect the constitution of the country, it does not recognize the state, and that over the last 30, 40 years has strongly pushed this ideology with violence until that they had abandoned their superiors in Zaria, that the security agency could not go. They could not go. National security is not just what we talk about. It has something, it has to do with our daily lives. We must, as an army and as a nation, understand that there is no other country than Nigeria. There is no way that once 70 million people will move to, should I be a breakdown of our order? Or if the army should fold its arms and step back because there are legal constraints? There is no way for once 70 million people to move to. Nowhere. And that's what's lacking. And I believe strongly that Mr. President, Commander in Chief, and the presidency will stand on the side of the people and, of course, the armed forces in Nigeria. Because, as far as I'm concerned, it's the armed forces that is holding this country together. Think for a second, we should just go back to Barracks for 24 hours only. It will be a disaster. And a lot of people are doing everything to force that scenario to happen, but we could not allow it to happen because our oath of allegiance to the state is unshaken. I continue. We have witnessed the manipulations of the press, especially social media, to distort the issues that necessitated such military operations. So presently, they accommodate terrorist groups, insurgents, and extremist religious groups, narratives that necessitated military operations in the first place. Total and poor understanding of national security is not exhibited, which calls into question whose interests they serve. The criticisms of these organizations and the backing of the loyal citizens notwithstanding, it is important that commanders at all levels realize that they could be held accountable for the abuses of their subordinates based on actions were not prevented or punished after commission. Let me talk about the way forward. Way forward, not so much that we're not really invading some of these things, just for the sake of emphasis and probably to share my thoughts on that. Inadvertently, the key factors that the military leadership must engage in is to ease the burden of command responsibility. First, a deep evaluation of the operational environment, including the underlying politics or containing forces is imperative. Commanders must be bold and appreciable time to study the environment in order to formulate plans and execute operations with eyes wide open. Critical actors that will influence operational outcomes are to be prompted into the loop without jeopardizing security. Furthermore, the criticality of general leadership at the tactical level was taken quite seriously during training and briefings. Also, periodic review of training curricula and use of equipment and weapons applicable to the operations must be factored in. A review of the type of equipment is necessary for specific types of internal security operations in view of the police-like roles of the military in recent times. Additionally, gender and race training is imperative to mitigate cultural and traditional incongruences that could inhibit mission effectiveness. A robust media is also a critical tool to operational outcomes. Media operations conducted in conjunction with friendly media is imperative to effectively take over the citizenry. In conclusion, the burden of command responsibilities has taken a center stage and open the bridge to all sorts of media and legal distractions. The inherent dangers to commanders is to avoid as much as possible what at time command paralysis. Command paralysis simply means that because of all these distractions, you don't have this inherent, you don't have this fear, they don't want to do anything. But not doing anything, the issue will explode. Again, I'll go back to Zaria, because that's like some kind of phone call. Let's say we do not intervene in Zaria. Just put in your mind's eye what will have happened. That because of the gate, 300 plus people die. Those are, as far as I'm concerned, they are terrorists. They are militants. Simple as short. As against the hundreds of people who are law-abiding citizens and going about their lives in Zaria. Political leaders must also be made aware that the military as an instrument of national power must not be rendered almost impotent towards endangering national security. When troops are constrained to take guided effective actions in operations due to undue and undefined fear of litigations, then the essence of the military is lost. Conversely, militaries must constantly keep an eagle eye and try harder to avoid unmilitary conducts that add no value to national security. Thank you very much.
The guest lecturer and the respondent has permit me to close with some few announcements. There will be a group photograph on the front of the Nigerian Army Resource Center immediately after the interactive section, after which we will now go for a tea break. The tea break will be in three places. For Major Generals, it will be at Nigerian Army Resource Center Staff Conference Room. For Brigadier Generals, it will be at the Conference Room A, which is the present day where I am. Then for Colonel below, it will be downstairs by the Conference Room B. There are ushers outside that will lead our dignitaries to all these venues. Thank you. Of Nigerian Army Resource Center, Brigadier General CFU Udaya. But before that, permit me at this point to please say a few words about our two discussants today. The first discussant, I'm sure if I'm to the lady city, I'm sure that will be another lecture for the day. But I will just say a few words about our first discussant, which is no other person than Major General A.A. Basque, former Corps Commander Artillery, former Chief of Policy and Plans, and please give him a round of applause. Second discussant is no other person than the Corps Commander Infantry, Major General A. Mohammed. Please give me another round of applause, please. I will end up discussing every aspect of this lecture, so I've just mentioned a few things about it. I invite you to go ahead with your comments, observations, or questions and answers, please. Thank you.
Thank you, MC. May I credit the audience of the special guest of honor to once more give a standing applause to the guest lecturer. Thank you very much, sir. Before we proceed with the interactive session, I just want to bring out some few points that I think will be of immense benefit to our participants. The guest lecturers talked about the burden of commanding responsibilities at state center stage and open the military to all sorts of media and legal distractions, which invariably or consequently depends on the conduct of operations made by subjects of public scrutiny in local and international media. And it suggests that it's important that commanders brief and supervise the actions of their subordinates properly and ensure that codes of conduct and rules of engagement are strictly adhered to, and that immediate sanctions for abuse of business and war crimes with stiff penalties would serve as deterrent and assuring victims of crimes and their families. Having said this, I want to set the rules of engagement for the conduct of the interactive session. We have very senior officers that will be discussing this paper. They will have 10 minutes each to discuss the paper. Probably they leave for the Chief of Army Standards and Evaluation. I will not be able to stop them during the interactive session, but I will be able to tap on the microphone. And if I do touch that, it's a sign that you are overshooting your time, sir. After the discussants, we'll take questions from the call here, three questions from the right, three from the left, and then the people in conference from B will take four questions from conference from B. So if you're in conference from B and you have a question, please do indicate I'm seeing you on the screen and we'll call you to make your either questions or contribution. Having said this, we'll go straight to the interactive session by inviting Major General E.E. Bassi, retired to.
First and foremost, let me appreciate the Chief of Army Staff and the DG and the Sustainer for the opportunity given to me this morning to share my thoughts on this all important subject, the burden of command responsibility. The choice of the presenter couldn't have been anything better. The GOC One Division. This is a senior officer who faces the burden of command almost on a daily basis. When you look at the kind of training you've had since you were commissioned, the experiences before you rise to the level that you have risen to, this has armed him adequately to deliver this job. And I want to commend him for doing a very good job. The presentation was lucid. Flow from beginning to end and use simple language that is understood by all. And of course, he kept to the purpose of his paper, which was to discuss attributes of command and its burden, drawing examples from contemporary military operations in Nigeria. And from time to time, he shared his personal experiences. He left the script and spoke extempore to explain and carry the audience along. That is how it should be. I commend you once again, GOC. Well, you cannot discuss burden of command responsibility without talking about leadership. Because leadership and command, they are intertwined. And he brought that out in his paper, leadership, command, and management. Because the commander also manages his men, the resources available to him. He looks after their welfare, their morale, and many other things. This, I expect that this audience already knows about. So I don't need to flog that too much. Whichever way you view leadership, our personalities will come to bear in the way one individual exercises command or authority over troops under him. Whichever way you want it. And these are some of the things that will determine the success of one individual or the failure of the other. No person is perfect. But with our training, we are armed or equipped for that day that will be placed in command of our men. And that is why he went into the attributes of the good leader. He enumerated in his paper, there are numerous. Think of the character of an individual. He must be trustworthy, integrity, he must have it. He must be honest, he must be dedicated, he must be able to inspire his men. I will just quickly share a little experience as a young officer. When I reported to my unit, my first encounter with my commanding officer, when I came out of that encounter, I asked one of my classmates who happened to be in the same unit. I said, "Is this our CEO?" He said, "Yes." Why was I asking this? Because the kind of pot belly I saw before in front of him, because I couldn't imagine. Hearing of my commanding officer. You know, at first meeting, I wasn't inspired. I must confess. To a commander, or a leader for that matter, must be able to inspire his men. First and foremost, you are bearing your outlook, the way you dress. And for us, for you, dear senior officers, your men are watching you. They may not be able to come and tell you that, sir, this is, I mean, I'm not very well understand, but it comes. Some of us retired officers, we are following the trend of events in the Nigerian Army, and we've heard that the chief is doing something in this direction. But be that as it may, this particular commanding officer knew his onions. He was very, very sound. He was the officer with very high degree of integrity. So all that one was able to make up for my initial impression of him. So you must be able to inspire. That is just one aspect. He was able to inspire me through his sound understanding and knowledge of the profession and the way he administered the unit. Courage, confidence. I think the presenter, DIV, dwelt on that long enough and shared his experiences. A leader, a commander, must be courageous, must be firm. I share an experience. When I was a commanding officer in Kaduna, my unit had a money market. and that Oyebade part of the land was actually on a land belonging to another company, to a civil company. I never knew that many years ago my predecessors had entered into an agreement with that company to use part of his land and give out to these petty traders to their shops. Because at that time, that company did not have need for that land. But the company did tell the Nigerian army, in an agreement, well, the unit, this was the unit between the unit and the company. They did tell the unit that when we have need for this land, we will give you so months notice, and you will do us the favor of removing these people. Unfortunately, that responsibility to remove these people fell on me the time I was a commanding officer. And I saw it, I said, what? So, thank God, records were properly kept, and this agreement was brought out. I looked at it, I said, what? So I called the all officers, called the RSM, called the head of the Mami Markets. Traders. We had a meeting and I told them, this is it. I'm good enough, before you even allocated a shop there, there is an agreement, there is a warning that these are temporary sheds which can be taken away. At any time, the army asked me for them. I spoke to them and I said, okay, it is not easy for this school to move. I'll give you 3 months. 3 months went by. They thought I was joking. Another meeting, I said, okay, 1 month. All this while I put the GOC, I put the relief commander, and they said, fine. What are you going to do? I said, well, I have to remove these people before the company takes the army to court. And after the second 1 month extension, before the expiration of the date, I made my arrangement, contacted the Minister of War's Cabinet, got bulldozers, got soldiers, and moved them to the site, the area where to clear the support out. It was only one trader who had the initiative of asking one of my officers, who came to tell me, say, is that your guy going to do what he has said? He said, he will do it too. Better go and move your things. I think that was the only person who had the time to remove his things. And when I came with my producers, started bringing down everything. How much the confusion? People were begging now to be allowed to move their wares to somewhere else first. I didn't go. I demolished everything. And if I did not have the courage to take that decision, I mean, it would not be, the problem that will come on him will be too enormous. But it passed and there was no problem because I had briefed my commanders, my senior, I mean, my authority, the brigade commander, the GC, the pictures, this one. Go ahead. So, your man will be watching me. If you do not have the courage to take certain decisions, you are likely to fail. One thing I should say here is that whatever decision you take as a leader, there will always be people who are for and against that decision. So, if you are thinking too much about people who will be against it, you will never have to take any decision or action. The important thing here is ensuring that whatever decision you take, you'll be able to defend it if you are called. And that's why leaders, commanders are accountable. They're accountable to your superior quarters, they're accountable to your men. They may not be able to ask you, but if things get out of hand, you have a problem in your hands. The mutiny in Akure by troops of the artillery regiment that was there then is still very fresh in our minds. It is because of payment of allowances that those troops mutiny. And I happened to be the brigade commander at that time. And I happened to be the same person that was directed by my GOC to go and suppress that mutiny. It was a difficult time when you have to face your own men. What most of you, some of you may know, but I guess most may not have known, that while this thing was going on in Akure, some soldiers tried to disarm the guards at the unit magazine and armory. So that meant that they had the intention to go further, to go higher than what was known to the general public. So, but when I was sent there, I knew that a group of men, these are our soldiers. We do not want bloodshed. We did not want it. But if we had to reach that level, well, but thank God it did not happen that way. I exercised my initiative. I got there. When we arrived, all of them ran away, abandoned all the roadblocks that mounted within the barracks. But I ordered that they should blow the bugle, cut at them. This was very early hours of the day, say 4 or 5 a.m. We arrived at 3 a.m. We spoke to them, calmed their nerves down. And they, you know, they decided that, okay, these people are not coming to do anything harmful to us. I told them, go and pull down your various quarters and assemble at some time. They were happy, they went, they came back. By the time they came back, place troops, you know, secure the parade ground where they all gathered. And we had a list before my arrival, we had a list of the major actors, the real leaders, and we called them all out. And those ones, the military police, put them straight to the bathroom in handcuffs and interrogation started. So I was able to do that without any bloodshed. As commanders, we must know, understand your environment you are operating. Weigh every circumstance properly. Never underrate any obstacle or challenge. Get yourself properly prepared before you launch yourself head on to any issue. So, like I said, decision making remains one of the critical responsibilities of a leader or a commander. Because you will be held accountable if the action you take goes wrong or faulty. Linked to this fact is a need to accept responsibility. When you take decisions and they unfortunately go wrong, you must accept responsibility. This is a virtue that I think is very deficient, and that's what I've noticed in present day Nigeria. I had a situation where a commander told one of my officers while I was in
Senegal, that he should go. I mean, he gave me an order to do something. And the officer called me in Senegal and said, "Sir, this is what the brigade commander has told me to do." I said, "What?" And when he took the action, and then there was so much you and cry all over. I said, he said he told him by radio. I said, "Wow, that is serious." But the officer gave me a feedback when they had to go appear before the GOC. The senior officer denied ever giving his officer an instruction. But the GOC at that time was able to decipher that was right in front of the GOC. He was saying, "Sir, you told me to go and do this." So the GOC saw it and excused the senior officer, the junior officer, and of course obliged his commander. And that was how the matter ended. It didn't go further than that. But your honor and integrity is being able to accept responsibilities for your actions. I was leading troops, my battery to Liberia, one of my officers decided to carry Indian hemp on board the ship. And when I discovered it, I dumped everything into the sea, thinking that if this thing is not seen, nothing will be heard about it. Why did I decide to dump these things? I was going into an international environment, professional environment, armies, there is troops from different countries, and here was I, commander of an artillery battery, an independent battery, and then the news is that we arrived with huge quantity of Indian men. I was not ready to accept that. If not for the other things, say, my name, my call, and all the goodwill that I've built over the years. So I told them. To my surprise, when we got to Liberia, we saw that it was not just an officer who was involved in this thing. He had civilian survivors, the owners of Indian Hemp. We arrived, they asked, where is my consignment? He tried to, put up a stubborn attitude, because he knew that I had thrown the consignment overboard. But the long and short of it is that the people reported him because they felt that the officer wanted to carry value for it. Now you would take the assumption that the officer would take the consignment and go and sell and make more money. So in their grief they reported him. But they ended up being arrested for even making that effort. Well, there was a lot of inquiries sent for SIB team from Nigeria. And I was asked the question several times, why did you throw away this consignment of Indian? And I told them, I couldn't imagine the uproar that would be raised here. The damage that would be made to the name of the Nigerian army, say troops arrived with Indian and blah, blah. And I just felt that, okay, I talked to my troops, officers and soldiers, nobody owned up. So I threw the thing away. Well, they saw the fault liners in my reply, and they said, "Okay, officer, next time, don't throw such things away. We need them as it is, because as it is, we cannot even prosecute these people because they drop in their cases. If there are no exhibits, cannot prosecute." So those are some of the experiences. Being in command position is sometimes can be very, very lonely.
Yes,
but you must do your best to ensure
that you get results expected of you. As officers, when you are out there in the field, you carry a lot of weight of responsibility on your shoulders. You represent your country. You are like ambassadors to your country. And if anything goes wrong, you will be held accountable. Remember the case of Lieutenant General Anor Kweno of Ghana, first commander, yes, in Liberia. He was sent there for a purpose, and under his watch, the president was hit, taken away and killed. And that, of course, led to his immediate removal and retirement from service. You must be very, very conscious of your responsibilities and trust it on your shoulders and make sure you come out of it successfully. Training prepares us adequately for responsibilities of command. I want to say that the study of military history is very, very helpful here. Military history will help you. See, sometimes we are always, you know, there you see a lot of journals on why or successes of one commander or the other or one campaign. We are, most times we don't look at failures. I think we should do ourselves the good of looking at failures too. Because I know there is a book on military failures. I saw it a long time ago. I'm sure some of you have seen it. I would advise that you read it through and see why some commanders fail in their assignments. The presenter enumerated so many instruments that will guide troops conduct in operations. The laws of armed conflict, ROEs, rules of engagement, rules of conduct, all these things, it's not just enough for you as the commander to have knowledge of them, but you must impart it to your men. It is very important. I bet you if you call some of the men under your command and ask them some questions regarding these rules and regulations or laws of profit, you'd be surprised they don't know what they're supposed to do in different circumstances. And their misconduct is going to directly affect you. So you go in the duty, if not to them, but to yourself, ensuring that they are well briefed and knowledgeable about all these rules of conduct. Gentlemen, one thing we fail to do, I don't know whether it's the habit of Nigerians, we don't like to delegate authority. As commanders, you must delegate authority. Don't carry the entire burden on your head. That's your subordinates. In that way, you are preparing them also for the position of leadership or command. Train them. You need the responsibility to train them, to prepare them. People who will come and fit into your shoes when you leave. So, on this note, they say my time is okay. I will quickly leave these 7 points with you. 7 habits spectacularly. 7 habits of spectacularly unsuccessful people. Yes, unsuccessful people. Because I've mentioned that we, most times it's success, success. We don't talk bother to look at why people fail. They see one, they see themselves and their forces as dominating the environment. Arrogance. That can't make you to become overconfident. No clear boundary between leaders' personal interest and that of the organization. leaders who think they have all the answers. No. I said, nobody is perfect. Nobody has all the answers. So as much as possible, you confirm subordinates where necessary. The case of the Egyptian lieutenant, engineer lieutenant, in the October 73 war is very instructive at this point. Leaders who ensure everyone is 100% behind the militating opposition. Not everybody can think the way you're thinking. So give room for dissenting views, and it will help you to succeed. Leaders who devote the largest portion of their time to the unit's image. You concentrate so much on one thing and fail to do other important things. You underestimate major obstacles. And then finally, leaders who revert to what worked for them in the past. We have a dynamic environment, things are changing very quickly. Yes, we may just don't have a knowledge of what transpired in the past, marry with what is in the present and see how you can use it to take a decision. Thank you very much for your attention.
On this note, sir, I want to hand over to the next discussant, General Manager, who will be able to provide the damages.
I'm going to copy my order. The representative of the Chief of Army Staff, senior officers, gentlemen. Let me start by thanking my brother, General Hamaki, for inviting me to discuss my experience here when I was a general officer commanding. I've read the lecture, I've listened to the presentation. So what I did is to select some key issues that were presented to relate them to my experiences, the burden I had to bear while I was a general officer commanding 7th Division. To Oyebade, I truly enjoyed that well-written and properly delivered lecture. I'm sure all of you here have had cause to learn a lot from it. I also want to thank the center for organizing leadership training here. I'm working on something similar in our core. What I've realized after going into several researches, unfortunately, our leaders in the army are not trained. If any of you doubt what I'm saying, go into research according to General Williams. He said you won't understand the depth of your illiteracy until you start research into a subject. Take the Canadian Army, take the British Army, take the American Army, and indeed the South African Army. Just look at how much effort they put in developing their leaders. A lot of effort. So thank you very much, sir, for organizing this workshop. Now, before I go into those aspects, there are some perspectives of leadership that were mentioned both by the presenter and the discussants. So I will key on to these issues. The first is innovation, training, management, character building and discipline, and indeed mentorship. And in relation to mentorship, the Rebasi just spoke about dedication. We must learn to train our successors. I'll give you an instance in the Pakistani army. You can never become a chief of army staff by mistake. The next chief of army staff is known. He is given command of the corps that is located in Peshawar. If the chief of army staff is going to leave the country for a day, that corps commander will relocate to the general headquarters and superintend over the whole army. So the aspect of mentorship, if I ask all of you here, we are commanders at this level, how many people have you mentored? It's a soul-searching question. You need not answer me here. Look deeply into your soul. How many people have you built? Are you yourself? Have you been built by others? I could recollect during the CAP week, they were abusing and opposing and they say all unprintable things about the young generation, that they are worthless leaders, they don't know this, we don't have hope in future when we live at Angola together. I stood up and challenged the Gabriel that, okay, you, what have you visibly done to change the psyche of these children? Is it just to abuse them? And the same you here, we have a lot of bad things to say about you. What have we constructively done to change your own psyche? Have we had the courage to punish those of you that are offenders? So please, let's look at this element of mentorship. It's very, very critical. The next thing is also personal to you. How many of you here have libraries? Our reading culture is very, 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 very poor. If you don't develop yourself, the army is too free to be carrying for training every day. It's not possible. Then what would you be doing? Only being trained, and when you exercise the knowledge you have acquired during training, we must develop ourselves. I will still give you an example with the Chinese. The number of universities in China, no nation has the number of universities the Chinese have today. Every single subject, they open a center for it. Let's try and develop ourselves, because a leader that is not knowledgeable is a very dangerous leader. He will commit atrocities, he will commit mistakes, and he will not lead properly. So the element of mentorship is lost. So all those that we pass through our officers will just be like him. So please, let's try and improve all our reading culture. Let's build ourselves, and then we have the possibility of becoming better leaders. Now, to the paper itself. My discussion will be tailored towards the realities of burden of command that I have experienced as the GOC 7 DIV. The first will be complete absence of mission command. I'm not running down anybody. I will present the facts and listen to them. When I was to be appointed in GOC, I was invited from Kontogura. I traveled, I think, 3 a.m. to arrive for the conference. I didn't even know I was going to be juicy because I was muting ideas on how I was trying to raise special forces that will win the battle for us, because conceptually, I had a different idea on how we are supposed to approach the operations in the Northeast, not knowing that I was going to be appointed the General Officer Commanding. I sat there while they were issuing the operational directive. And to my greatest surprise, it was an operational order. Everybody was deployed to specific tasking. So the element of mission command was taken away from me as the GOC. I could not exercise my own initiative. I had to play the script of somebody else. Now, the first challenge I had, if I give an example, is the whole Sabisa forest was divided into four: northwest, southwest, northeast, southeast. And there are like 103 battalion. They were tasked to take northwest of Sambisa. And ironically, I was the one who trained them in Accra. I met them, I inherited them. When they had their final exercise, I canceled it. I said, you guys are not fit to go to war without asking for any time from army headquarters. We canceled the exercise, we retrained them and extended the training. And I met them in the anti-aircraft gun, no BMG. They had about, I think, 8 or 9 general purpose machine guns, no mortar. They had 3 60-millimeter commando mortars and a fleet of vehicles that cannot be used as part of a force to advance into service. They attempted going into into Sambisa, and each time they were beaten back because of what they lack, both the capacity and the capability to undertake that serious responsibility of taking northwest of Sambisa, which covers about 900 square kilometers. And their task also was that they were to maintain rear area security. They were in Konduga. They were to advance, attack, defend, maintain their supply route, 650 people. Now, why am I giving this this story? That you will have a lot of challenge as leaders when you are implementing operational directives or the higher commander's intention. You must be innovative. When we couldn't get a headway, the other side, they also, the other group came to assist. We couldn't get a headway. So what I did was to abandon the Battle of Sambisa and then shifted to another group. This is part of being innovative. And here again, we met another stalemate, because the tasking was for 3 SOD. They were not up to 350. They were to take on the whole of Alagadu. After capturing Alagadu, about 350 people, then they will have to marry up with a 195 battalion at Ulakule. Then they will go for the north to capture southeastern part of Sambisa. We tried and tried. I think I was so stubborn, we attacked that place 6 times. I said I must capture that place. And based on our lack of capacity, we were unable to. Now, I'll talk on the status of battle worthiness of our soldiers. Here again, in Bauchi, I asked this fundamental question that I did not get the right response. Have we sufficiently trained our soldiers to involve them in counterinsurgency operations? Doctrinally, if we must use regular forces, who are the first forces to go in before the regular forces come in? Have we generated the number of special forces to undertake these operations? Here again is a full portal for you. What I did was to pull all my special forces, and then thanks to the Navy, they have these SBS boys. I've trained, I think I was the first officer to train with the Navy. When I went and saw what they were doing, I wrote a paper to the then chief of army staff. I told him, sir, I was a commandant 8 years, that the Navy has left the Nigerian army in terms of special operations 10 years behind. 10 years, I still stand by it till tomorrow. And it was premised on that we had to go and train with the SBS, and unfortunately, since I left, that idea died because it was vehemently opposed at army headquarters at that time. So I pulled the SBS and the special forces, spent a lot of money creating that force that I felt would assist and further the operations. But unfortunately, before they graduated, I went on sabbatical. Rear Admiral Medani said, Mohammed, you must never say you are retired when you went on sabbatical. So I choose to use that word. But today you have seen the creativity in the theater, the reliance of the training of special forces and their employment, how our operations are getting better and better by the day. I told the chief that, sir, these people you are sending as reinforcement, please, let me sit down and train them. Let me train them within the theater. I was not asking for a dime. That there is the need even to acclimatize them, somebody from Lagos, somebody from Calabar. We are just bringing him into the Northeast. And the same day, he's already in Matupi. That go and check history. When troops are inducted, there is an aspect of in-theater training, acclimatization, and other aspects of marrying up and go before these troops are launched properly into battle. What does the reply I receive? Look, my friend, you are not here to train. Whatever I give you, you use it. It was the most damning thing I heard as a GOC. Another aspect that we are still facing, even though now I have seen the chief properly addressing it, is the continuous usage of the same force. For those who are privileged to have attended courses outside this country, there's what they call used up. Once there's an encounter, those people that were in that bore the brunt of that battle, they are recycled. But due to the enormous responsibility and the expanse of land in the Northeast, we could not enjoy that. But thanks to the current chief, I have seen an out of rotation, and that is very good. It's enhancing the fire power and the way the troops are approaching officials. When I was in GOC, I tried as much as possible to juggle troops. Try and pull out those in front and send some behind. And that really, really helped my operations. Now, employment of the civilian JTF as part of co-opting critical actors that influence the outcome of the operations, the GOC mentioned it. The moment I assumed command, I went and met the governor. I said, Your Excellency, I want you to give me the civilian JTF because you have no right to employ the citizens of a state without the authority of the executive. Those boys were force multipliers. It's on record I took more than 3,000 to 4,000 of them. One of our battles in Alagamu, a lot of them were killed. But they never complained. They stood still fast. Until tomorrow, I keep saying, if we want to get to the root of all these problems, we're supposed to see how we can train them en masse. They know the areas. They have reasons to defend their own territory. Some of them are aggrieved. Even the displacement in that alone is enough for someone to wish to want to fight to reclaim back what he lost. In this regard, if we train enough, we can hand over even the aspect of border security. Because all of you know how porous our borders are. The army, the customs, and all this paramilitary, we cannot generate enough force to man our borders in the Northeast. It's impractical. So I also use the civilian PTM as part of those critical actors, and then the success since we recorded in terms of arrest of all these suicide bombers and maintaining peace within what Israel is there. I have a personal issue here, taking responsibilities for the actions of your support, of our subordinates. This is in relation to the jailbreak. I'm sure all of you are aware of that. When Boko Haram came and dislodged the troops of 21 Brigade in Kiwa Barracks. Till tomorrow, I'm still paying for that. I can't travel anywhere. Amnesty International is still asking for my head. What happened that day? We are going on one of our attacks on Alagaru, and unfortunately, the terrorists had inside information, because at that time we were trying to build a prison. So we had to employ a lot of civilian laborers. I kicked against that to help. Nobody listening to me. We had a fighting bout over the same location of that prison in Kiwabara. I called the chief. I told him, sir, it's inappropriate to locate this prison inside this barrack. It's not defendable. See, my friend, let that thing be built here. And unfortunately, the day he came up and he ransacked that barrack, he said, okay, why should we look for the governor? Let us hand over this barrack to them. Let them buy it. We will take the resources and go and build another barrack in the Malawi. Now, when the Boko Haram terrorists came and they dislodged our troops over the prison and they took what they could, a lot of those terrorists were killed in the crossfire. And sadly, those that escaped to the town, there was more action. More than 90% of those that were killed or that they were killed by civilians as part of more action. So in these circumstances, I was not even in that category. When I was trying to go where the fight was ongoing, the senior officers told me, sir, you are a GOC. There is a commander there. You cannot go and involve yourself in battle at this early stage. And by the time we got there, the battle was both lost and won. A lot of casualties, and mostly killed by the aggrieved people of Borno State. And now, where does the responsibility lie? Is it with the military or with the civil police? Actions taken by the mob in town. But till tomorrow, I'm the number one victim. I'm moved by those troops who are not even under me directly, because there I was a brigade commander. I was not even in the same cantonment. So till tomorrow, I'm bearing that responsibility. Now, what I want to add to this is, your complete absence as a leader can be influenced when you look at the dispersion. If you take the book by Boko Haram, who can you influence, who can you control? And based on our piecemeal deployment, because every village, once there is no soldier, they will leave that village. So we have thinly spread. To what extent can you influence that? But regardless of that, it's also a common responsibility. But it must be decentralized when we want to hold people accountable. If somebody kills people illegally at the central level, why must you call the brigade commander to account for that? And these are the issues. At every level I command, I don't hold leaders responsible. I go to the root. Say, who was in charge of this? I finish him. So we must learn to hold individuals at the level. commission of offense responsible for their actions instead of beating about the bush, looking for senior people just to victimize them and embarrass them. Now, illegal orders. So this is another thorny issue. What is an illegal order? I will connect this to what happened to me the day I was shot. The soldiers of 101 Battalion, still I have a history with them. I was the one who received them as the commandant, as the commander, I mean Commander Natra. They came the day I was leaving, or a day before I left to take commander's duties. I welcomed them and handed them over to the incoming commander. Sadly, these troops were deceived. They told them their equipment were with me in Natra. They came with nothing. I told them there was nothing with me. Then when they finished their training, I was already in GOC. They asked, where are my equipment? They said, well, your equipment are already in Kaduna. We don't want to do double hand in bringing them to Kotokora, taking them to Kaduna and flying them to Meru. When they go to Kaduna, they asked, where are my equipment? They said, they're already in Meru. Unfortunately for me, again, this would be the second time I will talk to these boys. Where are our equipment? I said, no, nobody gave me any equipment. I don't believe what they told me and I went for this. That I should do Boroboro. I hope you know Boroboro. You know why he was my MG. You know he was this. And then I should arm them. I refused to do it. Because those other soldiers, they also wanted to resist. That's how I think this arm was to have other people coming. Are we not fighting the same battle? Implementing that would have constituted an illegal order. That was an illegal order to disarm troops in combat, to arm those that were inducted. So here again, we must try to understand the separation. The same troops, I was to deploy them at the flanks at the border unit. With nothing in their hands, with only about 5 or 6 vehicles. To me, that constituted another illegal order. If I had taken those boys there, they would have been slaughtered. They would not last one day. If they were armed and equipped, why not? How could you deploy soldiers that you, morally, as a commander, you know that they will kill and wipe out these soldiers. I also refused to deploy them. And at times I used to regret why I didn't deploy them, because they were the same idiots that shot at me. So you see, at this level, we have to sit and discern what really was. You know, it was a legal order. But in the course of implementing it, that's the interpretation based on who is receiving that instruction. Could we consider that as an illegal order? Even though it had legal connotation, but the outcome of obeying such an order in the lives of the troops that are under your command, it was a very, very big burden. A huge burden where I refused to do something to obey an order that I believed was legitimate, but the outcome of it would have led to unnecessary death, or what I call avoidable deaths. So here again lies how you feel or how you interpret legal orders that are legal, but when you come to implement them, how legal will they be? No, the remaining 3 minutes, I will stand in. Now, the first thing is on the death of equipment. Here I want to connect this to innovation. As a leader, you cannot just fold your arms and say there is nothing and there is nothing. No. If you do that, you are a failure. You must be innovative. You must be creative. You must look for ways around. When we are facing shortage of vehicles and all these APCs, what did I do? As part of being innovative, I sat down with the health committee and my officers told me, sir, there are a lot of spares in Lagos and all these other technical stores. I said, really? I sent one of our EV officers. He went and brought me a very huge list. I said, you need all these things? He said, yes, sir. And look for Army headquarters. And Army headquarters approved it. Now the issue was how to move them to make the movie. I will forever remain grateful to Air Vice Marshal Okoye, my very good friend. I will never forget his rewards in my life. He was flying Charlie. We had some talk and he sit up there and said, okay, he can Air Force will assist us. Okoye went beyond, far beyond what was expected of him. To cut a long story short, all those spears, I think about 4 trailers, we moved them to Bilibuli. I have this mechanic in Natra, very good civilian. He had been working with us. And those of you that you know Adam, I moved Adam to Bilibuli. And then there were other civilian mechanics here and there. It was a full war effort. We have brought so many people. To cut a long story short, in about less than a month and a half, we were able to have up to 20 fighting vehicles we repaired. And the turnaround maintenance time of vehicles in the casualty vehicles, we reduced it drastically. And so we remain functional. So as leaders, the burden of living things as they are and taking the initiative to be innovative as part of the perspective of leadership is key. You can't leave everything that they are not supposed to be a leader. You must try. You must do something. Let people see that you are up to something. So on this note, for a long time, sir, let me raise my voice.
Teachers, General Mohammed has taught so many Nasi and Natra, General Basi in the Command and Staff College at the NDC. I know the characteristics of teachers is speakable and when they have the opportunity to, so they have spoken a lot to me. On this note, sir, I want to hand over to the MC for some announcements before we proceed.
Thank you very much, the moderator. Thank you very much, the moderator. This is a little adjustment on our program. We shall be proceeding now for a group photograph of the without aid gear at the entrance of the section. Thereafter, we'll go for a tea break for 15 minutes and we'll come back to this conference room to continue with the interactive session, which is the moderator of this moderator. We will be expected back by 11:46 hours.
Having said this, we wish that you keep your questions short, brief, and precise. This time I think I have the power to ask you to either stop the question or hand over the microphone to somebody else. I wouldn't say it sound anymore. So on this note, we want to start from the immediate trials. If you have any questions, contributions, or clarification, and kindly direct your questions to either the presenter or either of the discussants who want to answer the question.
To Judicial Intelligence Command. So my question is to the General Officer Commanding. In line with what Retired General Francis said, study of our spectacular failures, I would want to assume that you would have done lessons learned our after action review of the activities that took place in Zaria. What would you say were the major challenges that your command faced in conduct of that operation, and what can we do better in the future based with similar challenges? Thank you, sir.
But to mention the issues of rules of engagement, have you mentioned it over and over? There's a detractor needed to understand that we acted like the rules of engagement. Now, how did they receive the fact that we have rules of engagement and our voice operated in the rules of engagement? Did they really believe in our rules of engagement as something that we can stand on to do what we should do well? Thank you, sir.
What you can come, and my question goes to the presenter. The issue of command paralysis. So in the face of giving the commander a task without adequate resources, why? And secondly, where on the basis of public opinion and criticism, commanders are sanctioned, how do you appoint command paralysis? Thank you.
Speakers, and I would believe that whatever I say will simply be my perspective of understanding of the question, and of course, we also have our senior colleagues here who also share their thoughts as the session goes on. My brilliant general, you want to know about the after action review, of after action review on the lessons learned, the challenges of command. Okay, of course, when the Holy Spirit started on the evening, night of 12 December, they said, there is an existing Ushiyaki sector in Zaria, but reasonable strength, and of course, working closely with other security agencies. But when it's global to serious engagement with security forces, I remember the then CP was the area. The ACP in Zaria. The truth of the matter was that the police didn't have the capacity and the capability to do that problem. Even before it's the war, when the chief's cover was blocked from moving, and after repeated appeals by the PM and the lawyers, the tax director, at one stage, ACP came and tried to pursue them very close. And of course, the ranks of the armed, they call them the Hurrahs, I believe, they call them the armed guards, in the ranks know, there are so many numbers and we need to do something. And the police, I said, told us they didn't have the numbers to deal with that problem. And the problem is something that we could just wait until reinforcements came in, because that would have been, you know, it's about to go into mighty and men. And of course, I don't want to go through what I said earlier on and what happened. But what I meant is that, you see, the military involvement in internal security operations is essential, as one of the speakers said, military aid to civil authority or military aid to civil power. With respect to the military, it's actually, when we talk about civil power, we're talking about the federal government. Because the federal government has control over the security forces. Of course, that power is delegated to some extent to the state government. And that's why they have almost all the states, you know, provide some logistics and etc. to the security agencies, including the military. But except we have capacities and capabilities of all the security agencies, we still have the kind of problem that the block desire emanates. Of course, because the police don't have that capability, have to muster other troops under pressure, like for some areas around Zaga, to come in to help, you know, check the situation. Another important thing that we learned from that operation, and which in my division have made it a very, very, you know, standing structure, people know it as well as in there. Any operation that we go for, no matter how little it is, we must have the semblance of some officers or soldiers whose only task is to record what is going on. They're not involved in any engagement, their own job is what? To just recover. And I find that in my discussions with my soldiers, when we did that review, that even when soldiers were busy using their phones, snapping in action, because they've not been trained, they are snapping mostly the commanders instead of the action itself. And that's one of the things that we're trying to correct over time. So once there's any action, the first thing is that as you're moving in, soldiers have been assigned, their duty is what? To recover. Of course, it's now highest regulation, but see, the input of doing that becomes so much more, you know, stronger than, you know, what we've been doing before. Because at the end of the day, we had a barrier. And of course, issue of media operations. Looking back, I think that one of the things I would have done, as the was developing, we should have put in some media practitioners, at least to be embedded, you know, with the command headquarters, to be able to also report what they are saying, you know, as the event was unfolding. I'm not getting like you all knew, the media team, which I'm sorry, that day, they were not able to record that initial contact with the IMF. So the import of media production is very, very physical. But that's not to say that we didn't know that. We did quite well, like I said, I stand on my officers, I stand on my soldiers. But probably, if I've gone on the offensive without the media operations, maybe some of the understanding which we are beginning to see would have been erased. But then we must not forget one fact. That behind the scene there are players who also are using this incident or this event or this engagement as something to get at the government. And we are seeing that manifest in particular operations in the northeast, in the southeast, in the south south. What it means against the government. We must not forget the fact that no nation can survive when her armed forces now gets to a point where it now becomes constrained to take decisive action to safeguard the security of the nation. The SSS maybe around, they did a lot. Today, one of the things we learned was that, you know, we must have regular and up-to-date intelligence. This issue of it is my own sector, it is my own thing. No, one of the things I found out, I say, with all due respect to the other agencies, before they tell me anything, they will have reported it to their own higher up. And the higher up will now be like, okay, you can give some information to the GOC or the brigade commander or to the CEO of the case maybe. But the best of that, since you are in the same environment, you share that information with me. It's still on need to know basis. Nothing starts, of course, from passing information to higher up, probably to improve on the matter of information they are collecting from all over. Now, secondly, on the issue of rules of engagement. As far as I understand it, I think our rules of engagement is quite, it's robust enough. But the challenge, not on our side, but on the other side, is understanding or interpreting the rules of engagement. And it's always self-defense, like I tried to explain in my lecture. It might be at your house as a civilian. And an armor back comes knocking on the door with a dagger or whatever. Come back, and then he's wielding a dagger, first and second to your room, and threatening to kill your wife or your children. And let's say you have a danger. And you quickly pick it up and shoot it, and he dies. Now, would you say that person, that husband, has committed an offense? That's in self-defense. And for the military, like I said, the least people we have is a rifle. We don't have strong, we don't have strong police. We don't have tear gas as police. We don't even have rubber bullets. The least people is a rifle. And of course, when you have parts of young men who are willing to die attacking troops, of course they have to use what they have to defend themselves and to also ensure that the task they've been given is executed. So, what we need to do is to continue the process of educating our troops about the rules of engagement and also members of the public. Because we are talking here with the camera, I would say. The interpretation nowadays is that because the man is holding a machete, a dagger, or a dendron to attack you, you have no right to shoot him. How do you define minimum force? That's minimum force. You should have not waited until he stabbed before he knows that he has to take action. And of course, another issue that came up is the definition of excessive use of force. How do you define excessive use of force? Throughout that operation, we didn't use another mortar or artillery, then that would have been excessive use of force. But then, depends on the circumstances, because if you recall in the 80s, I can see right at the first day that I was in the island. Mortars were used because of the threats. And the commander at that time had to bring in mortars to suppress it. But if he had not done so, what the number of soldiers would have been killed. Then of course, most importantly, which we did very valiantly, as still of developing in Zaire, the military hierarchy was in touch with the political hierarchy. So there were enough of what was happening. There were enough of what was happening because the chief of army staff was updating the political hierarchy, what was happening. So it was as if there was something wrong, like the following day, they had what happened. Now, the second question, the top question, I think I've answered it for Uyai and Adeniyi. Uyai Sala, Bishop of Command Paralysis. Now, when I come to Command Paralysis, it's with the mindset of where the commander becomes afraid because of the place that we're seeing now. Amnesty International, education, the reports that also seem to protect the military, the nation's military, who is engaged actually every sector of our national life. Now, the thing is that the GOC or the government says, look, I don't want to allow everybody, what's the media you are, don't do anything. So you can imagine if the situation is developing in any states, probably an ethno religious riot. In fact, let me give you a good example. In Niger, just about 2 months ago, in the Adeniyi riot, what happened? A young man posted a blasphemous, posted something on social media. Before we knew it, the whole town of Adeniyi was in flame. The correct thing would have been to ask one of the questions asked by one of the police colleagues, this issue of abusing the human rights. You see, the issue of the military or the police handling of the military is long gone because we are in together now. In virtual policies of the federation, we have the army, we have the police. We go side by side. So, the other concept of calling in the military was on the assumption that we are all in our barracks, something is developing, we get so bad, Mr. President or the state governor makes a request to Mr. President confers with his security council, yeah, he gives our approval, orders the CBS, which comes out of state, the DOJ, I order you to move troops to support the police. We have gone past that. We have gone past that. We are here together today. We are here together today. So, the essence of having developing our capacities and capabilities is something that we must continue to do. And I said it here when the resource center was opened about the one year ago, and the Minister for Interior did the lecture there. I didn't ask him the question. The Nigerian army is so engaged in so many things that is not, is outside our core functions. And we must begin to develop those capabilities. We must take a review. We must review our technical equipment. It is going to be our engagement for the next 10, 20 years to come. We must look at our TOE for international security operations, what kind of equipment have we deployed. Lastly, also the issue of professionality. Again, this is where, I said, the political leadership need to be tutored, understand only that profession. You see, the other understanding is that because one soldier was killed, you shouldn't kill more than one civilian, or one militant, or one terrorist. That's the understanding. But it doesn't work that way. It depends on the threats. And the more important security of the larger population. Yes, about 300 people were killed there without oppression. But it was not just military action. Crossfire, using multiple cocktails, they never knew, they didn't know how to use multiple cocktails. You know, when you open this in a pocket, you have to put up this over and ignite it. Okay, over time, they just spills on the floor and you have your jelly gas. What happens? Just pass by the whole house. So at the end of the day, those things are not seen as, you know, terrorist acts. So it is a military that should be at the brunt of, you know, some of these savage attacks. So, when I said command paralysis, I'm saying as commanders, but as a situation, but if the situation is so bad, you must still take action. Because if you do not take action, and the situation, you know, worsens, it is still the same you, together with other security agencies, they will still be asked to deal with the situation. And that's what happened in Berlin. Before the police were moving, we don't say that. If we waited for the police, they had the capacity, but they had to move them from somewhere else. But who were deployed? They were like, okay, I told the people, you know, just go in and arrest the situation. And that was why, I think a year or two, the report that was going on was that the military again had killed people. But when they saw what happened, they realized that if the military had not come, it's going to be worse than what we experienced. So, please, as much as possible, avoid the command paralysis. Because no matter what it is, at the end of the day, the Lord will still follow you to take the necessary actions to salvage the situation. But you must also recognize that as quickly as possible, you must engage other security agencies. And like I said before, you must collate record, video, steel, whatever you can get. Okay, I think I've done this issue of handover from police to army. I think we have gone past that, like I said. We are in it together. As a matter of fact, I recall 2 years or so ago, at the height of the insurgency, there was an effort to pull out the military from our states in order to generate forces for the counter-insurgency operations. But all of the governors around Abuja, and then Mr. President, sir, no, you can't do it. I mean, this is the truth. They virtually every state of the federation. In many local governments, the flight, section, one platoon, and so on. But I believe that the government is also looking at developing the capacity of the police, you know, because it's a primary duty. They are supposed to be lead agency, you know, the mobile and the other regulars. Of course, I've talked about the review of equipment and so on. Look at what's happening in Lagos. Operation Awase is going on. About the last few days, I heard that the inhabitants of the Kulungu started running away because of threat of military attack. Now, leaders attack with good people and so on, where the troops are, or the troops are deployed. And because of that, we're able to clear all the military. But someone that comes tomorrow and said, no, it's excessive use of uniform. Then whose interests are you protecting? Is it the people, or the militants, or the terrorists who are making war against the citizens of this country? These are the things, that's why I said to my paper that the political leadership, the legal, how would I identify them? They need to understand how to interpret the relevant sections of the law. Of course, that does not excuse if any soldier does anything or any officer does something out of the ordinary. Like I told my troops, for instance, when you arrest a cattle rustler or an armed bandit or a terrorist or whatever, and you bring him into custody, no matter what you find out, no matter how bad it is, even though you found out that yes, he was responsible for killing one of the soldiers in that operation, I've got some soldiers too, I've had so many soldiers wound there, you cannot kill him. Because he has been captured or he has surrendered. If you kill him, then you have fallen foul of the law. But even because of engagements, the skill, not many what the terrorists or the military or whatever is having a game, then order for as long as we should have to get the government, if you put that one in place. And of course, I agree with the CP motion. We need, if the issue of massive orientation should be a continuing effort. It's not just stop at the command level. you know, up to the lower levels, you know, in the army, the police, the guests, and so on, we should continue to do that. CPO, you talked about, I think I've learned these two, MAC A and MAC P. It's the power of federal, essentially it is federal. It's federal that now delegate its authority or its power scope to the states. I thank you.